Birds flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Breeze drifting on by, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me, yeah. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me. Ooh, 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 ooh. And I'm feeling good. Fish in the sea, you know how I feel. River running free, you know how I feel. Blossom on the tree, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me, and I'm feeling good. Dragonfly out in the sun, you know what I mean, don't you know? Butterflies all having fun, you know what I mean. Sleep in peace when day is done, that's what I mean. And this old world is a new world, and a bold world for me.
Hey everyone, and welcome to Blockchain Banter. I'm Jen, and I'm joined by a few of the contributors of Palisade Crypto, along with Mark Richardson of Bancor. Thank you guys so much for being here. I believe we, did we lose a speaker? Let's get him back up here. All right, well, Keish, I see you in the audience. If you want to request to be a speaker, I've sent you an invitation as well. Okay, there you are. Awesome. Thank you guys so much for joining us, and thank you to the listeners for joining us as well. I guess we could start it off with hearing a little bit about our guest from Palisade Crypto before really hearing about what you guys are creating and have been creating. Keish, you originally reached out to us. Do you want to start us off? Tell us a little bit about you and how you got into crypto.
Yeah, absolutely. First off, can everyone hear me? Just want to make sure we're
yep,
all good.
You're perfect.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Excellent, excellent. So yeah, I got started off in crypto in mid-2020. So my background is in finance. My job title is senior financial analyst, for what it's worth. I work in corporate finance, so I guess I don't use my degree at all in the pursuits of my normal job. But in crypto, I was actually able to find out that, you know, there's a lot of technological innovation going on under the hood. And just in mid Q3, Q4, I just started paying more attention to what was happening in the crypto markets. And I started to realize that all of the things that I was taught in school, they were happening on the blockchain. And they were happening in ways that were in more of a hyper growth mode than I've ever seen throughout my entire career, and also throughout what I could possibly imagine. You know, finance is actually more of a field that lags than leads, right? And here I'm seeing, you know, finance at the forefront. I'm seeing DeFi at the forefront. And that just drew me in, along with the idea that permissionless blockchains can open up so many different possibilities that never existed in the real world. It really just, it sucked me in. And I just like tried to ground and pound and just start networking these communities. Cause like, I think this is the innovation of the century, and I want to be a part of it.
Awesome. Thank you. I want to ask you a couple of questions about that actually, but why don't we pass it off to Tuesdays? I think you're behind the Palisade account.
Yep. Hey, yeah, I got into crypto maybe 2018-ish, but for the longest time, I was one of those people that was just slowly kind of DCAing and just using Coinbase. And about that 2020 era, started looking more into it and realizing that I shouldn't be keeping all these assets on exchanges, and kind of drove me into learning more about self-custody. And then one of the drivers for me is definitely creating that generational wealth. I think that we're kind of at a opportunity here that it's almost like if our grandparents were buying like Coke or Budweiser stock and just holding on to it. I think that we have the potential for more growth than even that. And I'm really excited about the tech side of the space and what it could mean for generations to come.
Thank you so much. Dujo, do you want to go next?
Sure. Yeah. I guess the relative newbie here from Palisade. I started in crypto in 2021, drawn to the space by the concept of Ethereum being the world computer and understanding how dApps work and really getting into Web3, got into NFTs as well quite a bit. So that's kind of my background.
Great. Thank you. And what about you, Algo?
Howdy. I started crypto really early off, probably back in 2013, but I've been in and out of it throughout the years. I really got into it really heavily early last year, and as I met a bunch of the folks in Palisade Crypto, became great friends with them. I'm a computer engineer by trade, so I've always been a giant geek, so seeing the potential of this from a technological standpoint is what really draws me into it. Financial freedom is also one of the big pulls for me within crypto and DeFi in general. But just seeing how everything can just interact with one another seamlessly through blockchain just tickles that part of my brain that is the geek part of it. Yeah.
I love that because it's not only financial freedom for you, but it's also like an even playing field to give anybody and everybody kind of that opportunity to gain a financial freedom as well. Thank you. Mark, I know that you are super, super busy with the upcoming launch of B3. So I really just want to thank you for making the time to speak with us about DeFi education. I know how huge it is to you. So seriously, thank you for being here. And
my pleasure.
Thank you. I know that you're on these calls with me quite often, but I know that we do have new listeners constantly. And for those that are unaware, would you just tell us a little bit about you and the specific role that you play as a contributor to Bancor?
Yeah, certainly. I'll try and keep it short. I am the product architect and the head of research at Bancor. That means that I'm basically responsible for, developing the concepts and methods that allow Bancor to do what it does. I don't actually come from a finance or economics background. I was a physical organic chemist for quite a long time, and I just recently made the transition from the physical sciences to blockchain in January of last year. I think let's keep it there.
Perfect. Thank you so much. So, guys, I'm curious about Palisade Crypto because you are a DeFi educational community. I mean, that's how you kind of defined yourselves when we first came in contact and connected on Twitter and one of those threads. How do you actually define, like, I've heard of content creators and educators and influencers, but not an actual, like, educational, like, an official educational community. I'm curious how Palisade Crypto got started and what you actually do together as this community, how you work together and how it formed.
Yeah. So we actually met each other in another cryptocurrency Discord. Palisade Crypto mostly is out of a Discord, but we've started up a YouTube account and we do a podcast as well, and trying to do a few other things, maybe even brave the new horizons of TikTok if one of us dares to try to tackle that one. But yeah, we were all kind of regulars in another Discord, and we realized that we liked the idea of self-custody and we liked doing DeFi. And we kind of got the feeling that the mods and the team of that Discord didn't really appreciate the whole DeFi kind of seminars that we would do and helping people get onto that. They liked their leverage trading and they liked just kind of staying staying on custodial services because they felt like it was safer. So we started having those conversations in another Discord. And then from there, it just kind of kept growing and growing. It's people would hear like, oh, how do I set up a MetaMask? And since Discord, you can screen share and everything. We would open up our screen, kind of run through making a new MetaMask and what that means and how to add other other chain IDs and stuff onto there. One of the biggest things that we've had people kind of come to us and want to learn is how to actually bridge assets between other chains. Because it's kind of intimidating the first time you do it. So having somebody to kind of guide you helps a lot there. So we started doing that, and then we just kind of came up with other ideas of, okay, well, maybe we should start making some blog posts so we can just link to those, or maybe we should talk about it on a podcast, and that way we can just send somebody the link. And now we kind of have someone who came to us and was like, I kind of want to do a market recap of, he does it Monday through Thursday at the moment, of what the stock market is looking like and what the crypto market's looking like. So if you ever are like me, I just was traveling for a while and kind of out of the loop, you can watch those and hopefully get a good feeling of what's going on.
Yeah, it's a really interesting landscape that I think we stumbled upon, because throughout all of our discussions, not only were we realizing that people don't really know that like decentralized finance exists, I think it tacks on top of another problem that already exists, is that a lot of people are not actually financially literate to start. And so you now have this compounding issue where someone's onto the blockchain, they realize they want to make some gains here, but then they get stuck, right? They get stuck in the exchange setting because that seems safe-ish to them. Like, okay, you don't need to know how to manage your money to know how a chart works, right? You don't need to know like how interest works over time, compounding interest works, in order to leverage trade, right? You basically just need to have an instinct for it and practice and over time. And if you're good at it, you'll get good at it, right? But the challenge, I think, for a lot of people is that they don't understand just how their personal finance works in terms of investments and stuff. So we're really trying to fill that gap, which is not only just help onboard them to the blockchain, but also give them just some sense of financial literacy, even if it's a basic level of just understanding something like compound interest at a basic level in a more of a friendly group than more just like, say, taking a course or doing it through school or something. We feel like that can create a lot of just like opportunities for people, not only in crypto, but in the real world as well. Just that basic knowledge of how to navigate these things. It's something we're passionate about, and we look to be a welcoming community to help people do that.
So this was really just something that was organically, it just came into play. This wasn't something where you guys got together and you're like, hey, let's do this and let's become some sort of an influencer. Let's, you know, get our name out there. This was just something that you guys organically created to genuinely just help others understand DeFi.
Yeah.
Yep. And obviously, because it's organically created, the monetary or monetization of it, we have no idea what that'll ever look like, if it ever even does look like that. But that's kind of one of the things. We had some people at the AVAX Summit and ETH Dubai, and we were talking to other people, and VCs were coming up to us asking us, like, what's the whole point of the community? And then they're like, well, where's the money at? And they're like, okay, well, it was great talking to you. But yeah, I mean, it's definitely just because we love this space. We want to help other people get into it. And since it was kind of a hard barrier to entry for a few of us getting into it, we want to kind of lessen that load for others.
Yeah. Yeah. Just speaking on the like organic nature of it, I can say as a relative newcomer, you know, my first touch point with, you know, speaking to any other person about crypto was joining Discord and just seeing Tuesdays and Algo really, like, I didn't even know if they had jobs, because they were just like for hours and hours just like showing people you know, how to set up MetaMask, how to, you know, connect to dApps, and just really, like, you know, kind of being like a community help desk in a way. And it was just really inspiring for me to see that level of like knowledge share, just out of a passion to learn more. And that's what kind of, you know, drew me into kind of sticking around, with these guys and, you know, kind of passing that knowledge on to people that are new in the space. And then just like the brain share, right, of like having a group of people that are all tied into different aspects of crypto and DeFi, that, you know, we can all bring it back and share it out with each other. So it's really just like a feedback loop that helps everyone.
Yeah, and plenty of I know a bunch of other DeFi centric discords that are out there, but the amount of them are locked behind like a NFT paywall, or, you know, we had to like level up or something like that to get access to really good information. And we kind of want to be, you know, different. We want to be kind of against the norm and just pretty much have everything that we know up front as soon as you join our community, have it right there, and having people within our community are willing to help you out just from the get-go. And this, we kind of want to be, I guess, you know, unique in that way.
Yeah, network effects are incredibly strong when they develop organically, and we want to go that way. We don't want to go in terms of like, oh, just like buy a subscription to us or something, because like that's not how we would have felt appreciated if we were starting out. That wouldn't have felt good to us. That wouldn't have been a community we would have wanted to join. It would have felt really transactional. Since we started organically, we want to make sure that as we grow, you know, and as the space grows, that we can actually leverage our own network effects to help other people onboard to the space. Because one big thing in crypto is we win together because we are growing, and like there is a future for the space. So you can go it alone, that's great, but like if you go together, you'll win together.
Well, I think that's great too, because you're sharing the knowledge that you already have, but you're obviously reaching out and looking to find answers to the questions that you have currently. And I think that's kind of how this space came about. You know, this was something where you had tagged Bancor, hey, I've got some questions for you, and I want to give you the opportunity to get answers to those questions. Mark, if you don't mind, I would love for them to just ask you directly the questions that they have for you in regards to Bancor specifically.
Yeah, for sure.
Okay. You guys go ahead and you take it away.
I guess one of the questions I have is, hey, Mark, what are you most excited about for the launch of Bancor B3? Like that little feature that you are really proud of.
Yeah, it's a really good question. I think that the thing that I'm looking forward to the most is probably something like the auto compounding rewards. I think that this is a you know, it's been such a gas overhead for users for so long to sort of constantly interact with the contract and restake and everything constantly to make sure that their gains are as high as possible. But with the auto compounding feature that, you know, is auto compounding in the truest sense, and it doesn't drive a project's token into the ground. I think that that's going to be a novelty and a, you know, something that no other project has at the moment. And I'm really looking forward to seeing that come to fruition and watching people benefit from it.
So naturally, we kind of connected based off of kind of the context of another person on Twitter who's kind of known for being a little bit inflammatory about certain issues in DeFi, and with some reason, I guess, you know, given a lot of the challenges out there. My question for you in this regard is not pertaining to anything this person said, but like, how do we, as the space gets bigger, how do we make sure that when something like this comes up, you know, like how do we make sure that what's propagated is true, if that makes sense? I know a lot with devs, they like to ground and pound, right? It's best to get the product out and get the product out because that's your mission, right? But when things can go at the speed of light, you know, on the internet, how do we make sure what's coming out is true, and how do we alleviate those concerns?
Yeah, it's really hard. I think that, you know, one of the things that you guys raised in the conversation leading up until now is things like trying to improve financial literacy. I think that if you're using blockchains, eventually blockchain literacy is going to be equally important. You know, it's okay. We can speak frankly about, you know, the events that led us to meet each other. And I'm sure a lot of people on the call would have seen it anyway. But Chris Black had posted some stuff. He reached out to the developer team and community members to ask about a you know, basically an EOA wallet that had control over one of the contracts. And, you know, was kind of, you know, overly hyperbolic about it. We invited him onto this Twitter spaces to discuss it with us. We provided him with a whole bunch of documentation and also answered his questions directly. But despite, you know, the, you know, I would say that the relatively hospitable, you know, welcome that he actually got on our Discord and in our Telegram channels, he still acted like we were being evasive or, you know, didn't answer his questions when actually all of his questions were answered. And, you know, he then took that, I just think that the way that he behaved was not very helpful. And, you know, it reminds me a lot of this idiom, which is, you know, that there's no such thing as being dumb, right? Or it's not the case that if you don't know something that you are dumb. That's just not true. But to pretend to know stuff that you don't know, that is dumb. And I didn't know this about Chris Black until last week, but that kind of captures, I think, the attitude that a lot of the other people that I've met in the industry have towards him. And it's now the attitude that I share with them. But yeah, coming back to the question is, you know, how do you know that something's true or not? I think that at some point there is going to be a time where, I don't think that making appeals to authority is ever a very good idea, right? That's not a valid argument for knowing that something's true, but you can still use that as, you know, as ample evidence in some situations that something might be true, or that, you know, it's sufficient evidence to convince you that it's true. So for example, I think that this is why auditing firms are still so important. Now they're not the, you know, they're not the gospel truth on anything. And certainly, you know, we can convince ourselves that the more heavily audited a project is, the less likely it is to have any of these kinds of critical weaknesses. But it just certainly doesn't make a project immune, right, from being exploited or hacked or anything else, just because it's been audited once or twice. So I think, you know, it's okay to make that appeal to authority as a way of feeling better about, about what's true in DeFi or any other service on blockchains, but it's insufficient. And at the end of the day, you know, remember that I am an experimentalist. I think that if you really want to know that something's true, and you have a lot of your personal wealth at stake, eventually you really should just start making that personal effort to understand blockchain languages and to read the public code. I think that's kind of the way I'll kind of wrap up that answer, which is that I don't think that it's fair to require everyone who wants to interact with the DeFi protocol to put in the really long hours of making sure that they understand all of the code that they're interacting with. And for those situations, I think it's okay that we use something like auditing reports to try and work out what's real and what's not. But that, you know, if you are in the space as an educator, I do think at the very least you should be able to understand, what the things in auditing reports are referring to, if not being able to discover those things for yourself. And you can, right? There are so many resources already. And, you know, with the kind of educational content that you guys are talking about, I think, you know, doing stuff like audits, right? Audit reviews, right? Explaining to people what audit is found and how they identified it and what the consequences are or something like that. And more, you know, YouTube channels about how to write Solidity or read Solidity code and things like that. Eventually, I think that people's blockchain literacy will become sufficiently high that the kind of bullshit that gets through DeFi so frequently will just no longer be true. But that's it, right? We need a generally higher awareness among normal community members before we can ever be confident that these things are going to go away forever. And until then, best we can do is to help to educate people to find these things themselves.
So I guess to end that question, is there a single EOA owner that can drain all the funds of Bancor?
No, there isn't. There is an EOA wallet that controls some of the contracts, but people in the Bancor ecosystem that can control the funds are the users themselves. So even if we wanted to do something with the user's funds, like move it to for example, migrate it from version 2 to version 3, right? This would be something that would be really helpful for us as developers and as project operators, but the reality is we can't do it. Not just that we can't do it legally, but it's impossible. We need the private keys of the users in order to do anything with those funds. So no, it's not even that we can't drain those funds, but we can't touch them. There is no way for anyone but a user on Bancor to do anything with the funds that they've provided.
Gotcha. Well, that's always good to hear. I know a few of us do indeed use Bancor, so glad to hear that our funds are safe there. We had another question of just not necessarily just Bancor, but security seems to just be a huge, growing problem in the space. Why do you think so many teams have problems with either managing their security or just understanding, like, I would almost say the basic necessities of security?
I think I quote most of that. I think that there's more than one reason, right? So all this stuff that I'm going to say, I'm just going to mute this guy.
Sorry about that, guys. He's been removed. Yeah. Continue.
So I think that let's say that the frequency and severity of the security issues that we've seen, I'd say are symptomatic of this unfair sense of urgency that you get in DeFi. I'd say that when people are starting projects out for the first time and they have something like a Discord channel or, a small Twitter following or, a Telegram channel or something like that, that the community that rallies behind them can sometimes provide maybe a little bit too much pressure that wants them to put your product out before it's ready. Or certainly, but before it's been vetted by people with a much, more in-depth security knowledge than the team itself. I also think that there's a lot of inexperience. So it's not even the case that people are rushing stuff out, but even if they had all of the time in the world to be able to push out the product when they felt it was ready, that they still don't have the benefit of expertise to allow that product to be secure. I think that, this isn't necessarily a new concept. I think that we've just seen it sort of play itself out in spectacular fashion on blockchains. But, naive programming is not new at all. I think, if you have a look at some of the Linux distributions, not all of them are, as secure as the main branch. A lot of them are released with bugs and things that, cause that software to not operate perfectly. We've also seen in the video game industry when developers are
are forced to push a deadline and then, you know, basically wait for the community to discover bugs on its behalf so that they can patch it and you know, push an improved or fixed version of the game later. So there is this culture in software already, right, where things don't necessarily need to be completed before they get released. And I'd say a lot of that is bleeding over into DeFi if people have come from, you know, a software development background first. They're kind of inheriting, you know, that sort of production laziness. And yeah, the last component is just probably that hype aspect of it, where you don't necessarily need to have a good product, let alone a safe one, in order to attract people to invest in your project at the moment. We've seen many, you know, effectively crime syndicates setting up projects wherever they can, and, you know, not even having to set up anything that is particularly impressive. A lot of these things are just verbatim forks of other projects, but have just been, you know, transplanted onto another layer one or onto a layer two or something like that. And just the fact that code exists means that you're probably going to rake in a few million dollars. And certainly these people, I don't think, have any long-term commitment to that project, let alone its security. So I think that it's a blend of all of these things, right? It's a culture of sort of, it's okay to release software with bugs and fix it later. You know, the overwhelming demand for audits, right? So one of the reasons why Bancor V3 didn't come out as soon as we wanted it to was partly because we couldn't get a big enough auditing firm to agree to take it on in a timely fashion, because they were so overwhelmed with audits from other projects. So there is that bottleneck as well. Yeah, I'd say that there's no one reason. It's either a combination or a blend of these reasons, or, you know, there's probably even more that I haven't discussed, but certainly something like programming naivety and a lack of access to quality auditors is right up there on the most prominent reasons, in my opinion.
Awesome. Thanks for that. So one of the other things that's kind of a hot topic in this space, particularly when, you know, you're trying to educate people and try to network with people, one of the biggest mantras is always not financial advice, right? And part of that is because we exist in a very ambiguous regulatory framework. Do you have any expectations as to where regulation may take us in the next few years? I know there's both bullish things going on in the space in terms of basically educating a lot of, you know, politicians who are starting to kind of get it in some jurisdictions, but in some places we're starting to see some steps back. So what's your opinion on the overall regulatory landscape and how Bancor could be affected by it?
Yeah, obviously it's something we pay attention to quite a lot. So for those who aren't aware, you know, Bancor actually launched as a regulated exchange. We kind of predate that, you know, permissionless and, you know, anonymous, you know, value set for DeFi. In Bancor's version one, if you wanted to start at a liquidity pool, we would literally email you the forms, right? And this was because, you know, Bancor was under the thumb of the Swiss government, still is. And everything that we did has to be, you know, regulatory compliant already. We've since been able to adopt more of that, you know, permissionless and anonymous sort of product offering that the DeFi has become known for, and that's been very helpful. But that was also partially because of precedent. And I think that that's kind of where I want to go with this answer, is that, you know, in general, if something is already out there and people are already interacting with it and it's doing good work and is, you know, has a reasonable claim to being a good actor, then in general, governments will start to get behind it. I think that we've seen this already. So like where I live in Australia, the government is pretty,
accepting, let's say, of the crypto space, and they're not making any sort of huge movements to try and make it more difficult for people to interact with or anything like that. Basically, they're just content that if you're paying your tax, then you can do whatever you want on blockchains. I would say that there are governments that are even more positive than that, such as Singapore and the United Kingdom, that are actually looking to use DeFi products as a way to help establish or further galvanize their own financial industries. I think that when that kind of stuff starts happening, when we start looking at institutional use, but on a much larger scale than what we have today, things like KYC support and sort of ring fenced DeFi products are likely to be something that we start seeing much more of. It's probably not ever going to appeal to crypto Twitter. So it's not clear to me whether or not these ring-fenced systems will ever be something that regular crypto influencers or crypto community members are ever exposed to or know much about. But they're going to be there. And I don't think that they're going to care one way or the other, partly because I don't think that these KYC laws are going to be inflicted on regular users. I think that we're likely to see a sort of horses for courses type situation where there's going to be sort of DeFi in the way that it exists mostly today. And then a different version of DeFi, right? So something that is still controlled by decentralized protocols and something that still exists on public blockchains like Ethereum, but has a very strong KYC compliance aspect to it and tries to keep a very strong barrier between the non-KYC'd and the KYC'd money pools. And we've already started to see some stuff like this, right? Things like Aave Arc and everything else. So I think that from a regulatory perspective, it's normal, normal users probably don't have much to worry about as long as you're paying your tax, right? And that is financial advice, right? But make sure you pay your tax. That's never a bad idea. But yeah, with regards to being fearful for what regulators are going to do to you, I really don't think there's anything to be fearful of. In general, I actually welcome a little bit more regulation into the space because I think that things are, maybe a little bit too dangerous and that they could be a lot better with just the smallest amount of general sanity checks in place before people are allowed to interact directly with users of blockchains.
Mark, can I build onto that a little bit? You were talking earlier about this culture, like this kind of lazy culture that has kind of crept into DeFi a little bit more than you and I, and I'm sure a lot of us would like to see. Do you think that regulation would help eliminate that? Like, you're talking about it as a user perspective, but what about as a developer?
Yeah, maybe. And we'll see. I think that it might be the sort of thing where there could be one of the things that I think people might not realize is how expensive audits are. You could easily spend $350,000, for example, to get your protocol audited by a single auditor. And so if you're going to do this three or four times, you could easily run up, quite a bill. And so in some cases, it's not even financially possible for some protocols, especially new ones, bootstrapping themselves with the community on Discord to afford, an audit of that caliber. But wouldn't it be interesting, for example, if that was subsidized? If this was, sufficiently important and that governments did have, the well-being of their citizens at heart, to create some sort of public good fund to allow auditors to, to take on some of these projects and make sure that they're safe without having to, pay the $350,000 ticket, I think is probably worthwhile. But I think that mostly governments aren't really concerned about that. They're mostly concerned about things like,
anti-terrorism financing and money laundering practices and things like that. And I'd say that I obviously agree with them on that as well. I don't like to think about the possibility that earlier on in this call, I was asked what the feature is that I like the most, and I said, I think the auto compounding rewards is a really cool thing, and I'm really interested to see how other projects implement it and use it. But it does sort of give me pause that, what if a terrorist organization is going to make use of that feature? I think that that's a shame. I wouldn't mind, a little bit more pragmatism, I think, in the way that we approach DeFi and anonymity being able to put up some sort of, some sort of filter that means that if you are associated with a criminal organization that we can deny, access, like blacklist your wallet or something like that. I think that's probably the most complete answer I can give.
Do you guys have any other questions? I have one, if we don't mind. We're talking about filling the DeFi knowledge gap, and I think not necessarily in regards to DeFi. I mean, you can educate somebody on safe ways to interact with DeFi, but if they're interacting with a protocol that isn't necessarily safe without knowing that code, it's really difficult to know that, go ahead.
Yeah. There's even different, there's different types of unsafe. You can have a protocol's code that is, completely airtight. But if it isn't financially sound, then you can still lose money on it, right? So, this is one of the points in the conversation where I'm definitely not going to point fingers at anyone else, but I'm just, saying that there's buggy code, right? And, so things like Solidly that have been exploited 3 times and, all of these other familiar examples, right? Like the Ronin chain hack and everything else. These are examples of, I would say bad software development practices. But then there are other cases where software development practices have been good. And there has been no code bug, right? No exploit, no security issue in the code itself, but in the economic model that is behind it, not making any sense, that allows these things to become more dangerous. So it's not even the fact that you have to just be well-versed in smart contract languages, but also in economic and financial languages and concepts. And I think that this is coming back to what our guests were talking about at the beginning of this call when they started to talk about financial literacy. And I agree with them. It's just it's insufficient, right? You need both of these things. Both the financial literacy paradigm needs to be advanced, and also the smart contract code as well.
Yeah, that's a really good point. And we run into that as well when we're trying to recommend DeFi platforms or protocols, especially ones that are permissionless, where, you can't really say anything on this site is going to be safe, because with permissionless protocols, people can put any assets into them. Also things like impermanent loss, are maybe a little bit more difficult for beginners to understand. So we end up having to explain those concepts quite a bit. From what I understand, Bancor V3 does have some novel, protections or, something to make impermanent loss downside a little bit easier on you. Yeah. Would you be able to explain that to us?
Yeah, certainly. So, but Bancor is not just a DEX, it's also an insurance company. And so the way that it works on version 3 will be very similar to the way that it works on version 2.1, which is essentially that Bancor guarantees that when you want to withdraw from the protocol, that the dollar value
of your stake is worth whatever it is, assuming that you want, you want to be exposed to the asset that you provided. So an example is, let's say that you, you're super interested in SHIB, right? Or SHIBGF, which is actually going to be one of the whitelisted tokens on Bancor version 3. And so you provide liquidity single-sided, right, which is very different from other DEXs, meaning you can provide liquidity in just one token, not a basket of tokens. We then assume that whatever the price action is on SHIBGF is the value that you're entitled to receive. So if you provide $100 in SHIBGF to Bancor, and the SHIBGF token goes 2x, then you are entitled to withdraw $200 of total value from Bancor. Now, what changes there is that the way that the value that you're being given is denominated might not always be exclusively in the token that you provided. And this is just a consequence of the way that AMMs make markets. So if you've provided your SHIBGF tokens, for example, and the price has gone up, then necessarily there are going to be less SHIBGF tokens inside the protocol, because the act of people buying them from the protocol is what has caused the price to go up. Now, on Bancor version 3, we have started this new paradigm of, well, you don't necessarily need to make tokens with all of the assets inside a protocol. And this is actually a very profound change, because it means that the protocol can hodl some of its own tokens, and that means that the impermanent loss aspects of the system are much more tempered than they would have been on something like version 2.1, and certainly a lot more than it would have been on something like on Uniswap v3, where they actually accelerate that impermanent loss aspect of things. So the way that it's managed is better, so that you, even if we are in one of these situations where the token that you've provided has gone 2x or 10x or something like that, that you can still withdraw all of the tokens that you provided in the token that you provided. The chances of that happening are much better. And we think that that's a really important change from a user experience perspective. But even if the protocol can't, it will give you whatever SHIBGF tokens it can without impacting, the other users in the system. And then whatever the difference is, whatever the delta is between the tokens that you are receiving and the dollar value that you are expecting, the Bancor protocol refunds you with BNT tokens. And so when we say that you're protected from impermanent loss, it's important to realize that this is an insurance product, right? You are given sort of a cash payment that represents the value that was lost. And I think that that's one of the things that maybe is not perfectly well understood out there in DeFi. And it's one of the things that I would, you guys as educators, I think should certainly know about, because people are going to ask you about it. But yeah, it's possible that if you stake, for example, if you stake a token that does very, very well, right, like 10x or 20x or something like that, that when you come to withdraw, the Bancor protocol can't just like make new tokens for you if it isn't a token if it isn't the BNT token. And so it's an insurance payout that's associated with that withdrawal, where the delta between the dollar value that you're expecting and the dollar value that you're actually able to withdraw at that moment in time, that's what's refunded. Which is still it's a much, much better deal for users than you get anywhere else. And this is, I think, one of the reasons why, Bancor is being so favorably looked on by regulators, is that we actually are making that effort to make sure that users' finances are handled in a pragmatic way. Right, you actually aren't exposed to impermanent loss on Bancor version 3 or Bancor version 2.1. Yeah, I think that I hope that that answers your question.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely did. That's really cool. Thanks for elaborating on that.
Yeah, my pleasure.
I'm going to open up the floor. If any of our listeners have any questions for any of the speakers, please go ahead and request. I have a general question in regards to DeFi knowledge. How do you guys see that as it stands currently? You know, do you feel like we're gaining any sort of traction as far as like being in the space? I see more and more content creators and more educators creating all of this content and really looking to fill that gap. As Mark, a developer and you know, product architect of a major protocol, and Palisade Crypto as contributors to a content creation, do you guys feel that that's the same, or do you think we're still kind of facing this obstacle of overcoming kind of those not so genuine or sincere influencers or, you know, educators?
Yeah, go ahead, Savory.
Oh, yeah, sure. I honestly, I think we're getting there. I think one of the biggest challenges for this, particularly for DeFi on the DeFi side, is actually there's a lot of financial talent who understands kind of the concepts that are being built, but isn't, one, allowed to work in the space, and two, isn't allowed to actually advise anyone enter the space right now, particularly in the United States where I live. That's one of the biggest challenges, where we have so much brain trust that's flooding into the space in terms of developer knowledge and content. And you're starting to see a lot of that stuff work its way into the system. And it's really, really cool to see as people start making this jump into Web3 and building out applications. But what we're not seeing to the same degree is the same type of stuff in terms of, like, just explain to people how these financial concepts intertwine. Like, there's a lot of content creators out there, but I think there's only one or two that have gone really deep into showing how bonding curves work and how just slippage works and impermanent loss. And those items, they're a little bit more esoteric to understand, but they're really relevant to the space. I think a lot of it is just going to be as crypto gets adopted. We want to be there to catch some of those people who have those questions and be able to answer them for them, and provide some of that content. We're starting out to some degree on that, but like, that's a big passion of ours. But yeah, I think the more it takes center stage in traditional finance, I think that's where you're going to see a lot of the brain power come over and say, okay, well, this is how this works. This is how this works. You know, this is how options work here. This is how they work on the blockchain. Here are the differences. And then it clicks, right? But since a lot of people right now don't make that jump right now, I think that's where there's a little bit of a gap, but I think it's going to close a lot faster than we think it will.
Mark, did you want to add something to that?
No, I think that was that covered certainly the points that I was going to make.
So, Xavier, when you say not allowed to work in this space, you know, you are a financial analyst, you know, working in traditional finance. Are you speaking about, you know, who are these people that aren't allowed to work in the space that would otherwise be educators and well informed?
It's an excellent question, and it's certified financial professionals. Or aka financial advisors, people who are fiduciaries and manage people's money. When you work at a large corporate entity, I don't, but when you do, a lot of what you see there is that they have to meet capital requirements, and crypto is something that if they invest in, they would have to divest from other things to meet certain capital regulatory requirements. And so there's not that type of regulated financial crypto product that allows them to comfortably invest other people's money into it. And on top of that, if let's say you're just a normal person and you go to your financial advisor and say, I want to invest in crypto, well, the products that they're authorized to sell you are not products that are crypto related right now. So you have this space that's not necessarily geared toward, because the incentives are to keep them out of it right now. But once we meet that regulatory gap and you get these financial professionals and educators who it's their profession to actually manage money or show people how to manage their money, once that gets bridged, and I think via, you know, a bridge of reasonable regulation, I think that's when you start to see a lot of this stuff explode and grow logarithmically.
Thank you so much. I have one final question. So we're talking about onboarding users with safe and reliable resources, right? And Mark, you were saying earlier that, you know, up until last week, you didn't, you know, see Chris Black in the way that you do now. What are some red flags? What are some things that people can look for? Because I don't think that there is a lack of resources. I think there's a lack of honest resources out there. What are some things that people can look for in regards to, you know, like the red flags or something of that sort?
Yeah, no, I would say that it's a very difficult question to answer. I still think that you shouldn't use unaudited protocols as a general rule of thumb. And you know, if a protocol is claiming to be audited, I think that it is worth looking at the audit report and making sure that the auditor is someone that is you know, respected or has some clout in the space. I've seen a whole bunch of these, you know, alleged audits from token teams that are trying to get whitelisted on Bancor. But when you have a look at it, really, the audit was just was provided by, you know, some guy with a Gmail address or something like that. You know, so like, not all audits are created equal. There are very well known, very respected auditing firms, and despite what you might hear from people, really, they're all pretty good, right? And using an unaudited protocol is very, very dangerous. That I would say that is the number one red flag that you should be looking out for. Like, not, you know, this hand waving excuse for, oh, you know, audits are coming or something like that. They're actually really insisting to see the reports before you to commit capital to that platform is a really sane idea. A couple of other red flags are things like how fast development cycles can be. So, for example, if there's a developer that's released, you know, multiple different platforms, and is, you know, somehow responsible for all of them, and that these things are happening in very, very fast turnaround periods, I think that their attention might be spread a little thin. And that they might not have the, you know, it's unlikely that they would have put in sort of the effort to ensure that their protocols are sound before releasing them. So that's another red flag to look out for, is basically too many projects. And yeah, I think that these are the two biggest ones, the most obvious ones in my view, but I'm interested to hear from our guests as to what they think are the biggest red flags.
Yeah, I mean, audits is definitely something that, like, we've learned to read, kind of know what to look for, and it is definitely a little bit of a learning curve there. But I mean, one of the other things that, like, we've started looking at is not even just the project, but like, who's behind the project. So even if it's a team that's completely doxxed. There was a project that I actually still am invested in because I like the technology, but one of the VCs behind it is like notorious for pump and dump. So it's kind of one of those like really hard things of like, how would a normal person know that this VC normally does pump and dumps? And it's like, well, you wouldn't, unless if you've just stared at what they invest in the charts. But yeah, I mean, one of the guys in the audience is also a part of our team, Super Synapse, and he brings up, oh man, I forgot where I was going with that. He wanted to do the shout out and now I forgot, but sorry. Yeah, it's just going through looking at projects and, it takes a group of people to really kind of sit down and review a project. And that's kind of what we've started doing at Palisade, is being able to lean against each other for financial reasons, whether or not the tokenomics makes sense. I mean, obviously Savory here understands finance very well, but we have some people who can read Solidity, some people who are really good with finance, and then just the overall tech side of it and where it could go. Having multiple different aspects or viewpoints to kind of source information from is kind of how we have started achieving some success for ourselves.
Yeah, we had a similar event like this happen. I believe it was just yesterday where someone just jumped into our chat that we knew we were friends with. And he said, hey, what do you think of this? And we're like, hey, this is kind of cool. So one of us took the tokenomics side of it, dug into who owns it. Like, what are the tokens actually distributed for? Is there like a venture wallet? Is there a community wallet? One started reading down the website and the white paper. And we were able to provide a lot of knowledge just like by just, you know, working in parallel and being able to process that out. And that's kind of a testament to just how difficult it is right now, because there isn't exactly, you know, an S1, you know, if something's releasing a token, like if you're going public in a stock market where there's all these disclosures, you don't have the luxury of that a lot of the time. So you have to, before you even start looking at it, you have to kind of like feel it out and see what are some of the potential red flags here. The one thing we always caveat is there is no possible way for you to know 100% because no one's giving you a guarantee, right? So there is some personal responsibility with your investments where you could easily invest in something and it is in fact legit, but you don't make money off of it because like something happens. So there's always that side of the equation, but you know, the more people that you involve in your process, the better result you're going to have. That's one thing that we really, really like emphasize. Don't go this alone, because I assure you, if all of us in this chat right now were still trying to just find our way blindly on ourselves, there's no way we could consume enough knowledge in order to discern whether something is that we just found a day or two ago is a good investment. And sometimes time is money for you. So make sure you're going with other people you trust, because that's one of the biggest deals that will help you navigate this space.
So if somebody wanted to, like we were talking earlier, and my final question, I promise, you know, you are a DeFi educational community. If somebody wants to join the community, they have something to contribute or they have questions for you, Discord would be the best way to, you know, kind of become a part of the community and to continue to fill their own knowledge gap.
Yeah, we definitely try to push people to join Discord. We think that over like Telegram, it's a way more structured way of having a conversation and be able to have other people join in on that conversation. We've chosen Discord, and there's pretty much always somebody in voice chat. We have a few European people who are always in voice chat during their times, a lot of US people, and we're trying to break down and get some Aussies in there, but they're hard to find sometimes.
Yeah, I would say we are definitely a voice community. So please, like anyone who wants to can feel free to join our Discord. We don't sell anything. We don't have a token. Like that's not our aim here. So like if you come and have questions, like we'll be more than willing to one answer them if we know it. And if we don't know the answer, we're more than willing to just learn together with you. If you connect with us via voice chat, I would say that it would definitely expedite the process, because if you join like through text chat, we'll definitely like try to like reach out to you and see what we can do to help you. But almost always someone's in voice chat, and we'll be able to respond to you very quickly in that setting.
Yeah, and all of our social information, our Discord link is all on palisadecrypto.com. Or you can click on Palisade here in the chat, and we have a link in our profile.
Awesome. Thank you guys so much. And it's so true. Like doing it on your own, it's a really difficult space to navigate through and to learn all of the different aspects of. And that's kind of the point of the spaces here that we do as well. Try to educate everybody and give them a sort of platform to ask their questions and seek answers. Thank you guys so much for being here tonight. Well, tonight for me. And Mark, thank you. Tuesdays, Algo, Dujo, Keish, thank you guys so much. And thank you to everybody who joined us. If you have any additional questions, please don't hesitate to reach out to me.
Thank you so much for having us.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you so
much. Thank you, Mark.
Appreciate this a lot.
Absolutely. Appreciate you guys. Thank you so much. And everybody have a good one. Thank you.
Adios.